On today's program, we travel to Old Harbor, Alaska, one of the most beautiful harbors in the entire state of Alaska. Don't go away. It's a great show.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved.
Hi, my name is Herman Ahsoak. I'm from Barrow, Alaska. Heartbeat Alaska. We'll be back in a moment.
Heartbeat Alaska is brought to you in part by Coastal Villages Region Fund. Thank you, CVRF, for your support of Heartbeat Alaska.
Hi, I'm Mark from Scan Home, and we are proud to sponsor Heartbeat Alaska.
Scan Home, serving all of Alaska's home and office furnishing needs. Thank you, Scan Home, for making Heartbeat Alaska possible.
Heartbeat Alaska is brought to you in part by Brown's Electric Lighting Gallery. Thank you, Brown's Electric, for your generous support of Heartbeat Alaska.
By the Nature Conservancy of Alaska, working with Alaska's rural communities to conserve and protect our natural heritage. Welcome back. Travel with me now to Old Harbor, Alaska, a place where the Alutiiq people have had a history for hundreds and hundreds of years. Old Harbor, a beautiful place with beautiful people. It sits on the southeast coast of Kodiak Island, tucked into the hills behind Spruce Island. The people who live here are as rich in spirit as their land is in history. In 1784, the area was visited by Russian Grigory Shelikov and his Three Saints flagship. Three Saints Bay became the first Russian colony in Alaska. 4 years later, a tsunami destroyed the settlement, and within the next 4 years, two more earthquakes would take their toll on this unfortunate town. In 1793, the town moved to the northeast coast of Kodiak Island. And almost 100 years later, a settlement was re-established at Three Saints Harbor, a settlement now known as Old Harbor. Inhabited by the Alutiiq people, Old Harbor is perhaps one of the most beautiful towns in all of Alaska. It is perched on the banks of the Sitka-Litik Straits with the backdrop of the Konyag Mountains. The people of Old Harbor have close ties to the ocean and land around them and partially live subsistence lifestyles. Many of the residents are commercial fishermen like their ancestors, who not only relied upon the waters to provide whale and seal, but also lived off the land, hunting deer, rabbit, fox, and bear. But Mother Nature has not always been so kind to Old Harbor. In 1964, the Good Friday earthquake left a lasting imprint on this land and its people. 76-year-old George Inga Sr. remembers it well.
We were walking on the beach when it started shaking, you know. And we were at the beach. First it was little, you know, it got stronger and stronger. After a while, we could hardly stand up. I look up the hill, there was rocks rolling from over that rocky place over there. They were rolling down. And next thing I know, I heard my boy crying, and I looked behind. We were by the old dock, some old foundations were there, you know, them posts. He was holding on to one. It was shaking so hard. I went to the house and collect some sleeping bags. And then when I came out of the house, we used to have boats anchored. Out here we didn't have no boat harbor. I had my boat anchored in front of my house. I looked at them, I thought, how could the boat be running without no one in there? They were anchored, you know, the tide was so strong, they were just like going ahead, swelling, that's how strong the tide was. And I look up the hill, and all kinds of people were going up the hill. First two came in. It didn't come as a wave here, you know, because that's an island out there. But it came with a strong tide, just like a tide. First two wasn't too bad, but the third one, the bay dried up. The whole bay dried up from the dock to across that little beach over there. It all dried up. Yeah, the tide went out. The whole bay dried up. And that's when it came back. The water went all the way back to the lagoon, and then Old Harbor was low in the back before this, you know. And when it came back from there, the first one was okay, but the third one, that's when it wiped the houses. After it got dark, and we spent the night up in a hill. It was pretty cold that night. It was pretty spooky, you know, with the houses going out, squeaking and bumping each other. The only one that didn't go out was the school and the church. The church, there was about 2 feet of water outside. It never moved. And when next day, when in the morning, I don't know, Sven and somebody else went to church, opened the door, there was not a drop of water on the floor. The grass plucked all the, what do you call it, on the door. Wouldn't let the water go. Not one icon was on the floor. You know, it was so strong, the tide, the earthquake, even the church bell was ringing, just like somebody was ringing it.
The town has since been rebuilt and has become a popular place for sports fishing. During the summer, many of the residents, like Mike Tunohun Jr., cater to the tourists who come here from all over the world for some of the best halibut and salmon fishing anywhere.
I'm in the process of removing the skin from the halibut. Usually cut down the middle, right on the line. And, okay, this is the process of removing the skin. Okay, and from here, I section them 2 to 5 pound portions.
Mike used to live in Old Harbor, but now he lives in the city where he attends art school. And like Mike, many other people had to move from Old Harbor when the price of fish dropped after the Exxon-Valdez ran aground in 1989.
The oil spill has played a devastating effect in my community personally on how many boats are fishing today. The fishing industry, the prices have always fluctuated, but never to the extent that they did from 88 to 89. And, you know, there's only one thing that you can attribute that's the oil spill. But nevertheless, the people are here trying to survive, having a difficult time surviving, but we're trying to come up with different ways of allowing our people to succeed and as far as, job placement.
Well, I'm trying to create work, you know. I'm trying to create some work and some jobs. And I try to keep it all in the community, like this job here, you know, on this fuel farm. We only had like 2 outsiders coming. We had about, at one time, we had 14 of them from the village working, you know.
Those kinds of opportunities that come along, there has to be a way to ensure that our people are going to get the bulk of the jobs, because they need to work.
But there was no lack of work in Old Harbor when it came to getting ready for the 4th of July celebration. Wanda Price is a director of the Alutiiq Dance Group in Old Harbor. She and her students have been busy getting the dance regalia ready for the holiday.
The top part that you see is the headpiece for a traditional Native woman. And these symbols, the more beads you had, you were the more wealthy you were. And the traditional way, the Alutiiq way, is your eyes are covered. Women were never allowed to look up. Your eyes had to be covered. You always had to look down. And the, like I said, this headpiece, that would be a chief's wife because of all the design. They'd trade beads. They'd get the birds. Everything would be handmade. Everything would be traditional, made out of seal, sinew, ivory, whale, and the bird's beaks. The regalia that she is wearing right now is a traditional woman's regalia made out of rabbit, fox, weasel, and the same meaning with the headpiece, the more beads, the more ivory, the more decorations you had, the wealthier you were. And the drums we have were made out of seal hide and the bark of the trees. And the strings would be made out of sinew. So everything was all natural. Nothing was wasted.
Don't go away. We'll be back with more Old Harbor right after this.
There's a heartbeat louder than thunder. Revolution.
Are you traveling to Anchorage for education or health care? The Alaska Family Hospice is your home in the city. Located 1.5 blocks from the Alaska Native Medical Center, Alaska Family Hospice offers fully equipped apartments, housekeeping services, shuttle service, Medicaid payments, grocery shopping service, or cook your own native food right in your apartment.
Well, I've been coming here for the last 3 years, and all the time I come here, we know it's like a home away from home.
For total comfort, affordability, and safety, come on home to the Alaska Family Hospice, your home in the city. Was this community preparing for the festivities, but they were also preparing for the arrival of an honored guest, the Bishop Nikolai.
Well, it's part of the diocese that I've been chosen to administer. The Diocese of Sitka in Alaska is an old diocese in the Orthodox Church in America. It's actually the oldest diocese in the beginnings of Orthodoxy in America. And on March 21st, I was elected to be Bishop of Baltimore and auxiliary to His Beatitude Metropolitan Theodosius, who was the locum tenens, or the official administrator of the diocese. And I was chosen in his capacity as a bishop to administer the Diocese of Alaska. And I arrived here, it'll be 2 weeks on Thursday, and the arrival has been just tremendous. From the time I stepped off the plane in Anchorage with this huge number of people, clergy and people waiting with crosses and icons to welcome me, singing Ispolaiti Despota, which means many years to the bishop, was a tremendous reception. Has just continued. Coming to Kodiak last Friday, going to Uzinki yesterday, coming here yesterday, as you experienced yourself, the people waiting out in the rain for their bishop to arrive is a tremendous experience and something that you don't see so often in the lower 48. You see it in larger parishes, but not to the magnitude that you see here.
Not bad. Good.
Alaska is less inundated with all of the other distractions that we have throughout the rest of the United States. You don't see a lot of movie theaters, and you don't see 7-Elevens and arcades and all of those kind of distractions that are here. And you see in the village here and in Nuzinki, where the church is the center of the village, everything that they do is centered around the church. Where would you have that kind of reception midweek anywhere else?
Happy 4th of July. Everyone is to meet at the church at 11 o'clock. 11 o'clock at the church. Happy 4th of July. Our church service will start at 11 o'clock. Everyone is encouraged to attend. Please come, one and all. Happy 4th of July.
Today is probably one of the less busy days I've had since I've arrived in Alaska, because the busy part of the day doesn't start till 11 o'clock, which is considerably later than it's been in every other day. So it's been very nice to be able to soak in some of the atmosphere here before the festivities begin. At 11 o'clock we're going to the cemetery and having a memorial service there for the departed. And Father Kenneth tells me that the cemetery is almost full, that we're going to have another piece of land for the cemetery, which we need to care for, because we have to bury our dead and pray for them, as we do in our church. From there, we're going in procession down to the pier, and they'll have a service. We'll have a service there to bless the fleet, the fishing fleet. And these services of blessing, you know, boats and that come to us from the Typikon, which is our book of services that we have in the church, that are hundreds of years old. So fishing boats have been blessed for centuries in the Orthodox Church, because it's been a mainstay. We know that the early apostles themselves were fishermen, and so those vessels by which they were providing their means were blessed, and that's what we're doing today. And the fleet will go by, and I'll bless each one of them as they travel by us, and then we'll be here for the 4th of July, which is our secular holiday. But we'll bless the holiday, the secular part of the holiday, with the blessing of the fleet, and the remembering of our departed.
And after the blessing, the boats lined up for the annual boat race, which was more like a boat free-for-all. Then it was time to go from the straits to the streets, where the Alutiiq dancers performed a ceremony welcoming all those to their village while sharing a little bit of their culture.
We have, last year and the year before, we've been working with K-12, and we even have the little kids sometimes come out, and preschool kids we've worked with. So all the kids that wanted to join, I started out with five students. Like 5 years ago, now we're up to 24, and there's only 60 kids in the school right now. And so sometimes I have to switch off. Some kids will say, okay, I won't dance this time, I'll dance next time. And the kids are real interested in it. And there's one thing that we push, they're not here to get paid for it. They're here because, like I said, for their pride, for their parents, and to honor our culture. And so the kids are real proud of that. Bashfulies means it's an old traditional story where this chief from a village, you know, back then they said, okay, you're my daughter, you're going to marry this certain person from another village. Well, she was in love with another man. So bashful eyes is, she's hiding her eyes on the beach when the other dad is bringing her new husband to be, because they were chosen for you. You didn't have any choice. And she's hiding her eyes, and that's what bashful eyes is.
It brought out the kid in everyone, and everyone brought out their kids to partake in a variety of events that lasted the whole day. Like the candy toss, to sweeten things up. And the quarter toss, which I might add, is very popular. Speaking of toss, don't forget the balloon toss. And the egg toss, which cracked a lot of people up.
Oh, boy. We're already too far ahead. Throw it a little harder.
There was also the traditional tug of war for the women and the men. And these two who found the dog to be more interesting than the rope. The gunny sack race got the place jumping and built up a lot of appetites, which was a good thing because there was plenty of pies to be eaten at the pie eating contest, which left a funny look on a lot of people's faces. But not as funny as the pudding eating contest, which should have been called the pudding feeding contest. And although they're meant to float, these buoys were bouncing during the buoy race.
Come on, teenagers, come on, from 12 and under. Come on, all you kids, get in line here. That's $20, $15, $10, or $12.
Surprising enough, after all these events, the kids still had enough energy for the hill race. The object, race to the flag at the top of the hill and back to the finish line. Kind of reminds you of Jack and Jill, doesn't it? As the day rolled on, things took a turn and a tumble and a right hook. That's right. One of the events was boxing. It didn't matter if you were male or female, 14 or 4. This event was open to all. And in the evening, the entire town gathered to light up the sky with an awesome display of fireworks. Fourth of July is over, but there is still a remnant of hope and excitement in the air. The expectation that life and traditions carry on. To the outsider, the community of Old Harbor may look like a town destined to fade away, but the residents here know better. Like the surrounding mountains and never-ending washing of the tides, the people of Old Harbor will be here tomorrow.
Old Harbor ain't gonna die, I know that much. It ain't gonna die.
This is a great state and a great nation with incredible diversity of life and cultures. These times of divisiveness between peoples test this greatness.
Come, be a part of history. The We the People March will be August 22nd in Anchorage. This year's theme, Alaska Tribes, the next 10,000 years. We need your energy. We need your funding. We need your help. Call 279-2511. That's 279-2511. And we'll see you at the march.
Each week, Heartbeat Alaska brings you great stories from all over the state. And we couldn't do it without the generous support of Frontier Flying Service. Frontier gets our camera crews where they need to go. So whenever you see a Frontier plane, give them a wave.
Say hi from Nutset.
You might just be on Heartbeat Alaska.
Frontier Flying Service, covering Alaska for over 50 years.
Hi, I'm Martha Keegan. Welcome to an island suite.
Heartbeat Alaska wishes to thank Martha and the whole Keegan family.
We'd like you to make this your home away from home.
She made sure we were very comfortable during our stay on Kodiak.
I like meeting the people that come through, and I love showing people around.
With a full kitchen and laundry facilities in the room, staying in an island suite can save you time and money. And the complimentary coffee's not bad either. An island suite, your home away from home.
Good morning, Island Air.
Island Air has been serving Kodiak Island for over 20 years. With scheduled service and charter service to 6 different destinations around Kodiak Island, the mainland, peninsula, and up and down the Aleutian chain, Island Air offers quality service at affordable rates. And if you love to fish, Island Air would love to take you there. They offer same-day fly-in fishing and bear viewing trips. So when you find yourself on Kodiak Island, be sure to visit Island Air for your island travels.
Thank you so much for joining us for Heartbeat Alaska Native News and Native Information. I'm Jeannie Green. Hello once again to Canada and the Lower 48. Hello to all my good friends in Alaska. Stop by and see me. I'd love to meet you. That's 6216 Old Seward Highway right here in Anchorage, Alaska. Until next week, God bless every single one of you, and we'll see you then.